He's coming here to visit. He's inshallah tomorrow delivering a short course with Sheikh Ahmed Kuti on Maqasid al-Sharia. It'll be at University of Toronto Scarborough campus. Dr. Yasser is Saturday. Sorry, not tomorrow. Sorry, I apologize. Not tomorrow. It's on Saturday at University of Toronto Scarborough campus. So Dr. Yasser is here. We asked him to give us a short khatira on Maqasid al-Sharia. So inshallah, maybe a few minutes after. Actually, there's no sunnah. So inshallah, we'll start the lecture now. Inshallah.
What time is it?
So it's after Dhuhr. So I can get to the details.
2 to 6.
Yes. So 1:30 is Dhuhr time. After Dhuhr, we have 2 p.m. From 2 to 4, Sheikh Ahmed Kuti is giving a lecture on the fiqh of minorities. And from 4 to 6, Dr. Yasser will be giving the lecture on Maqasid al-Sharia, or which is translated as the intent of Islamic law. And it's going to be specifically in University of Toronto Scarborough, room AA112.
A course that is rather a technical topic, in the sense that it talks about the Sharia and its implication in today's world, and its implementation, and the ijtihad and fatwa and all of that, that we discuss inshallah when we talk about that topic in a course. Yet, the basic definition of what's called Maqasid al-Sharia is something that actually every Muslim has to be aware of. Despite the fact that Maqasid al-Sharia, according to scholars, is a shart, a condition for ijtihad or for fatwa or for siyasa shar'iyya and all of that, and it is very important, but at least a basic definition should be in the mind of every brother and sister. Why? Because Maqasid al-Sharia is actually Sharia 101, rather than something that's very advanced. It is the basic principles behind our Sharia. Let us just use a few minutes, inshallah, for a few definitions, like what is Sharia, and what is Maqasid, and what, this is very important for us to know, because sometimes we use words that we don't really understand very well, and sometimes the words are misused by Muslims, and often by non-Muslims, without Muslims correcting the non-Muslims for what they are talking about, when they talk about. So we often hear talk about Sharia. I was in the States last week, and it's a huge debate. I was in Washington, D.C., and it's a talk of the town in Washington, D.C. And nobody knows what they're talking about. Sharia, shara'a yashru, is something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a way. Shari'a, we say in Arabic, shari'a. Shari'a is a way. Sharia, linguistically, is a way in the desert that camels follow to the water. So it's a way to the water, a way to quench your thirst, and so forth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called the Islamic way of life Sharia. ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيعَةٍ, the language of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Surah Al-Jathiyah, ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيعَةٍ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ فَالتَّبِيعَةٍ, and we had established for you, or we have put you on a way. In any English translation, all of those dozen translations that we have, if you open the translation, you will see that Sharia is translated as the way, or the road, or the straight path, or the straight way. And that is the translation. So Sharia is really the Islamic way of life. And for a word that a Western mind, since we're talking here in Canada, a Western mind would understand it, we could say that Sharia is the Islamic ethical way of life. This is the Islamic ethics. This is how we practice Islam. Of course, the practice of Islam has individual levels, has family levels, has sometimes state levels, things that are related to the state, which are very few in the Sharia, and things are related to the family and the society, which are much more, many more than the things related to the state, and things are related to the individual, which are many, many more. Because the Sharia is about how I live my life. And then, in case of certain disputes and certain events, like Allah forbid death or divorce or in the other, you know, nice events, marriage, etc. Sharia organizes some rights and responsibilities between people. That's on top of the Sharia being for me as an individual, for my ethics. And then on top of that, there are things related to the state, related to, you know, the definition of some crimes and their punishment, related to definition of things related to peace and war and all of that. Yet, Sharia is mostly about my ethics, my life, my behavior as a person. And that individual behavior is something that we often overlook when we talk about Sharia. So we don't, we think that the Sharia is about the Islamic criminal law, which is part of the Sharia, but it is a small part. And it is not really, you know, a part that is central in the application of the Sharia. It's something that comes in an advanced kind of application. It is an integral part of the Sharia. Yet it does not define Sharia. It is an exception rather than the rule. But the rule is the ethics, is the principles that I go by in this life as a person. And these principles are these maqasid. Now, what is maqasid? Qasad, yaqsid, maqsid. Qasad means a purpose, and a goal, an objective, an end. You know, qasdi Mecca. My objective is to go to Mecca. Qasdi khayr. You know, my purpose is good. My intent is good. The brothers translated the word maqsid, intent. My intent is good. The maqasid of the Sharia are the intents of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has intents different from us. He has maqasid different from our maqasid. There is maqasid bashar and maqasid Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Maqasid al-bashar, maqasid al-mukallaf, they call it in the linguistic, in the language of the fiqh. The maqasid of me as a person is whether I intended to do this or not, whether I was, you know, under certain, whether I was forced to do something or I have a free will to agree to this. This is my intent. The intent of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed this Sharia, this way of life that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam embodied, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his embodiment of the Sharia was the embodiment of the Quran. Aisha radiallahu anha said, "Kana khuluqul Quran." His manners was the Quran. She didn't even say like the Quran or parts of the Quran that this is that. She said, "Kana khuluqul al-Quran." His manners were Quran, were the Quran. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam embodied that. That, why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send this Sharia with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and send this way of life? All the ibadat and the mu'amalat and the ahkam and the suluk, not just, you know, not just the ahkam, not just the rules, but also the behavior. When you pray and you concentrate in prayer, in your prayers, that is Sharia too. In addition to, of course, raising your hand and doing the ruku' properly and doing the sujood and praying three and praying four and two and doing the adhan in a certain way. But a part of the Sharia, a part of the deen is to pray with concentration, is to think about what you are saying, is to make dua. Yes, part of the dua is to be on wudu and to raise your hand and say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to raise the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so on. And this is the fiqh of it, but that's not the only fiqh of it. The rest of it is to give dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with hope in your heart. This hope is ibadah, and it is part of our Sharia too. This, when you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your feeling of your faults and your shortcomings and your mistakes while you are praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, at-tadarra or at-tadarra, you feel humbled when you pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also Sharia. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send the Sharia? For these things, for these principles to be achieved in this world, for these feelings that you are supposed to have of ta'abud and so on. I wouldn't get you into the technicalities of it, because it's something that we teach in a university course over, you know, many months. But I would summarize what the Sharia is about. Sharia is first of all about Tawheed. Tawheedullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammad brought, and everything that is in Islam, from the prayers to the zakat, to the hajj, to the has something to do with tawhidullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And anything that goes against tawhidullah is something that goes against the sharia. So this is one principle of the sharia, just to give you highlights. Another principle of the sharia is what's called at-tazkiyah. At-tazkiyah is purification. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, إِذَا أَرْسَلْنَا يَدْعُ عَلَيْهُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ. Like in Surah Al-Baqarah mentioned it in two contexts with Prophet Ibrahim. وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam purifies them and teaches them the book. خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِرُهُمْ وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ بِهَا. تَزْكِيَةً. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. Many places in the Quran, tazkiyah is mentioned. Purification. What does it mean to be pure? You know, to wash and to be clean and to do wudu and ghusl. Yes, this is part of the sharia. But this is the outer cleanliness. The sharia aims at an inner cleanliness from the inside. Tazkiyah is something from the inside before it is from the outside. Of course, I have to be clean and I have to do my wudu and ghusl. And I have to wear clean clothes when I pray and I have to But I have to be clean from the inside too. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions tazkiyah in the Quran, He means the tazkiyah from the inside, the purification from the inside. So when you give zakah, you are purifying yourself from greed. And when you do salah, you're purifying yourself from your sins and from your faults and so on. And when you do hajj, you purify yourself from everything, from the whole dunya. And you wear something that's very similar to a shroud, and you go and you say, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, here I come Allah. So you purify yourself from everything. And so forth. So everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made as a shara for us, as a law, we mentioned law, but law today is about the state, you see, and the government and courts. And so it is perhaps a better translation to talk about ethics rather than law, even though parts of the sharia is about the law too. But in any case, this is also another technical issue. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends us these akhlaq, these suluk, these ethics with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the form of practical things that we do, the tazkiyah, the purification is one of the main principles. And if I pray without this purification happening to my soul, and if I give zakah without the purification, if I do hajj without the purification, then there is something wrong with my prayer or hajj or zakah, because I have to do it for the sake of purifying my soul. I have to feel that I get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by doing these things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also revealed the sharia, one of these maqasid, or a group of these maqasid that scholars talked about, is what's called masalih or maslaha. Maslaha means the common good, you know, the common good of the people, the well-being of the people. What is the common good in Islam? What is the understanding of common good in Islam? If you had by any chance studied, you know.
You can't go outside the park, but we're trying to listen to focus. Can
you come on? If you had any chance to study what is good or what is common good in philosophy or in politics or in any of these dunya ways of approaching that, people usually approach good in terms of pleasure, in terms of what makes you happy. And whatever makes you happy is good, kind of like the old new philosophical question of what is good. In Islam, what is good, what is maslaha, is actually something that is much more structured and much more mature than that. It's not about my pleasure. It is about, of course, it's about my pleasure eventually in dunya and akhirah, but it's about a number of components. If achieved in a society, then this society has this maslaha. It's a mujtama' salih. This is a society that is good, that has acquired good. Scholars had surveyed the sharia and then came up with this theory, and there is some sort of a consensus, kind of ijma' over this theory, that summarizes the maqasid al-sharia in terms of the good. After tawhidullah subhanahu wa ta'ala and after the purification of the soul, we are talking about what scholars call hifz al-deen, wal-nafs, wal-aql, wal-ird, wal-nasl, wal-mal. What is that? They say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed this sharia, this practical rules and ethics of Islam for the sake of the preservation and the protection of faith, hifz al-deen, the preservation of faith. Everything in Islam is aiming at and has a purpose of and an end of preserving my faith, preserving Islam, preserving la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And in terms of the Muslims in a Muslim majority society, preserving their faith in the sense not of, of course, their faith is a wrong faith in the sense, but their faith, their freedom to practice their faith. So in the Sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're not supposed to, you know, destroy their churches or their synagogues or their temples and so on. We're not supposed to kill a monk or a Buddha and so forth and so forth. So in terms of people who are not Muslim, in a Muslim society, in a society overwhelmingly Muslim, these people are supposed to have the freedom to practice their faith and to do their ibadah and so forth. And we all know that. Unless, of course, there's an issue of war and etc. But in the normal case, they have the freedom to do whatever they want with their faith. And Muslims have their faith preserved. It's not supposed, nobody's supposed to compromise asli deen, you know, the basics of the deen. Not everything in the deen. This is the very, very basic of the purpose of this sharia. To preserve this deen, this tawheed, and to spread it, this is something that is very Islamic and very much a principle in the sharia. To spread that Islam, to spread that word of tawheed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then, after that, they say, hifz al-nafs. This is the second principle in this group of principles. That, of course, as I said, it would be explained in a long course, but basically, the second principle is the preservation of the soul. Or, if you wish, in English, would be a better translation, the preservation of life. Human life is very sacred in Islam. And anything that compromises life is something that is right after the compromising of faith in its danger on Islam. But it comes after faith. So I can give up my life for the sake of my faith. This is a priority, you see. But faith is more important. Then comes life. The preservation of life is something that is not just according to one hadith or one ayah. It is something that is widespread in Islam. That a human life is something that is very valuable. And no individual behavior or societal behavior or policy in government or public work in a public organization should compromise a human life or anything in the human organs and the human, you know, a soul, the nafs. And that is a principle that is very important because oftentimes we say to understand that in Islam it is very important to have hifz al-nafs. But on the ground, we don't see it. We see so many wars that are unfortunately happening between Muslims themselves. And of course, there are other wars from non-Muslims of Islam and all of that. But we are talking about Muslims compromising Muslims' lives. And especially today, if you look at the Arab world, where I live, where I came from, and you look at the Arab world, we are realizing that we, before 2011, were governed by governments that don't care about our lives. And they prove it every day. Now that we came out and we told them, okay, we want more justice, we want more dignity. We want to be a nation like other nations. We don't want to be treated like that. The easiest thing is to kill the people. And that is a basic in principle in Islam. That what else is left from Islam if human life becomes so cheap? So that, you know, people who ask for, you know, they say bread, we want bread and freedom, or we want some, and they lose their lives. And that is one of the main reasons behind for those who are not updated and not, you know, visiting the Arab world during that time, one of the reasons behind what's happening in the Arab world. People's lives became so cheap, and therefore they had to say, no, this is wrong. This is not, there has to be a principle against the compromisation of our life. Our life is not cheap anymore. Our blood is not cheap anymore. And that is a principle in Islam, right in the maqasid of Islam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, human life. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would care not just about a human life, about, you know, a cat or a dog in the street, about a bird, you know. And the hadith, you all know the hadith of the bird. A life of a small animal out there in the Arabian desert, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would care about and would the child by the name Abu Umayr, the Prophet, his bird was sick. So the Prophet, every time he sees Abu Umayr, he tells him, what happened to the bird? Is the bird still sick? This is Islam. Islam that cares about life of birds and flowers and so forth. Not a culture that is quite indifferent about human life. So that is a principle in Islam, and that is something that's very important. I said I will give highlights. Then after life comes what's called hifz al-aql, or the preservation of mind. The preservation of mind or intellect is something that is very important too, because after life, the next important maslaha, the next important good in Islam is to preserve the mind, one's mind. And that's why, you know, khamr is haram and mukhaddarat is haram, or any intoxicant is haram, and anything that makes the mind compromised is haram. Whatever you name it, and in whatever name or shape or form, it's haram, and it's a major sin in Islam. Why? Because this preservation of mind, to keep your mind, to keep your sobriety, and your intellect, and your consciousness, is something that is very much a principle in Islam, right after keeping your life. So after preserving one's life, one has to preserve their mind. In Islam, mind is not just preserved and protected, it's also promoted. In Islam, طلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم ومسلمة. You know, seeking knowledge is an obligation on every Muslim male or female, the Prophet ﷺ said, and so forth. So there are so many things in Islam that promote the mind, not just protect. We're not just talking about protecting life, but also promoting life. Not just protecting mind, but promoting mind. And that is something that is also very important and also very Islamic. And this is, I'm talking about the foundations of the Sharia, the things that the Sharia are built on. The Sharia, when it's asking us to seek knowledge, it is asking us to protect our minds and to promote our minds. And when it's asking us to be careful with human life and to be careful with the human being from the embryo stage to the death stage, it's asking us to preserve life in all of its forms, again, not just the human form. And then after the preservation of mind, there is the preservation of dignity, حفظ العرض. In Islam, this is also another human concept that you don't find in the philosophical definition of good. Often, like, good is usually material, or something makes me happy, or something that, in the common culture, something makes me rich, or something makes me whatever, but not something that makes me dignified. This is an Islamic principle also, an Islamic concept that is right in the heart of the Sharia. That people have to live a dignified life, dignity, al-ard. If you wish for a modern Arabic word, al-karama. Some scholars use that, hifz al-karama in the Sharia. So the dignity, that when we humans thought about writing some human rights charters, we wrote that as item number one, you know, the UN Human Rights Charter, for example. Item number one is talking about human dignity. Yet, on the practical sense, we don't really materialize that. Islam is very much about dignity to the extent of preserving my dignity from a word that somebody says, or from any insulting look that somebody, you know, all the ahkam, all the rules and the akhlaq and the ethics that we study about backbiting and ghiba and namima and slandering, and al-qadf and al-shatm and laysa al-muslim shattam ala al-aam al-sukhab, and everything that has to do with Muslims having to be at the highest manners when they deal with others, with their tongues or with their bodies, with their, you know, physically, they have to be at the highest manners. This is about dignity. This is about preserving people's dignity. And al-ird, kull al-muslimi ala al-muslimi al-haram, damuhu wa maluhu wa irduhu. This is right from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that a Muslim is a sanctuary. His or her blood and his or her money and his or her dignity. This is a sanctuary. We do this not just out of the exchange of benefits or a social contract or whatever. No, we don't do that out of that. We do that out of believing that Allah had given us this dignity inside us, and we have to protect it and preserve it if we respect that deen, if we believe in our Creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the Quran, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. We had given the sons and the children of Adam dignity. Dignity. This is also an Islamic concept, and that is why we're not supposed to speak ill about your brother or sister. That is why I'm not supposed to say something or accuse your brother or sister of something, whatever it is, not just adultery. Adultery, of course, is a big, big accusation. There's actually a punishment in the law, in Islam, for that. But also, any accusation, وَمَنْ يَقْتَرِفْ إِثْمًا ثُمَّ يَرْمِ بِهِ بَرِيئًا فَقَدْ احْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا. If somebody does something wrong and then accuses somebody else without a right for this accusation, فَقَدْ احْتَمَلَ بُهْتَانًا, then he or she is carrying a huge burden to accuse somebody of something that they didn't do, and so on. This is out of respect of human dignity. And then in the masalih of Islam comes after that حِفْظُ النَّسْلِ, the preservation of offspring, of children. The rights of children, we call it in the today's language, but the rights of children in Islam extends way beyond the age for labor and all of that. It goes all the way from the embryonic stage all the way to all the stages. And the preservation of especially the link between the children and their parents. حفظ النسب, they call it in fiqh, the lineage preservation. Everybody should know their parents. Well, fine, they could be raised by somebody else or whatever, according to whatever circumstances. But Islam really is adamant about the parents and about knowing the parents and preserving that link somehow with the parents. And of course, giving a great reward for people who raise children that are not their children. Of course, there's a great reward in that in Islam. Of course, in Islam, adoption is haram in the sense that people are not supposed to be named after somebody else. Their original names have to be preserved, so that they know their families, they know their fathers and mothers. But in Islam, adoption in the sense of raising somebody else, raising a child, this is a very, very Islamic part of Islam. Without changing the identity or anything, but raising them, this is something that has a great thawab from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the preservation of offspring, the preservation, حفظ النسل, حفظ الذريه, this is something that comes in that group of masalih. And then at the end of it comes حفظ المال, the preservation of money or wealth. And this is actually, this is how the Sharia is about. المال, wealth, comes after my children and my dignity and my intellect and my life and my deen. After all of this comes my money. So I can sacrifice my money for my deen, of course. In fact, في سبيل الله and all of that, spending in the way of Allah. I sacrifice my money for my aql, for knowledge, for gaining a certification, for paying a teacher who teaches my children, etc., etc. I sacrifice my money for my ird, to protect my dignity. In fact, there are a number of poetry in the Arabic poetry. أصون عرضي بمالي لا أدنسه لا بارك الله بعض العرض في المال. حسان بن ثابت, for example. The point of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hassan, he's saying, I protect my dignity with my money. What dignity? What money do I have if I lose my dignity? Like, if I lose my dignity, what do I have? I have nothing. So I could protect my dignity with my money and pay whatever it takes in order for me to be dignified, and for my children, of course, that comes also before money, to be dignified and to be educated, etc., etc. And in Islam, by my brothers and sisters, this is actually a prioritization of the Islamic worldview, like if you wish. Like if you look at this world from an Islamic point of view, this is how the world should look like. The faith is protected, and then life is protected, and then intellect, mind is protected, and then dignity is protected, and then wealth is protected. And then wealth is cheap when it comes to the protection of any of the above things. Wealth in Islam doesn't come first. And in Islam, we don't believe in the scarcity of resources. People in economics, they say that there's not enough resources in this world, so we have to fight over wealth. No, we don't. We believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had made this earth. سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنْ Allah had made not just what's on earth, what's on earth and in heavens for you. That's so much. It is so much. But in Islam, in order to protect the wealth, you have to protect the mind. Not just the mind, but also the dignity of people. What wealth do they have? These are very wealthy nations that we see in this world. But wealth means nothing if people lose their dignity. And then they become miserable. And they are wealthy. They are wealthy. They just spent thousands of dollars on what they drank. But then because they lost their mind and they lost their dignity, then they are poor in that sense. They are not rich. They are miserable. In Islam, you could be poor in terms of poverty, in terms of, you know, having less amount of dollars, but you are dignified, and therefore you are rich. And that is why in Islam, we have al-ghina ghina al-qalb, you know, richness is in your heart. The Prophet ﷺ talked about richness. That is the definition in Islam. So this topic of maqasid al-sharia, or the principles of the sharia, the principles of Islam, is an important topic. We need to put this in mind when we think about Islam, because all what I said is Islam's big picture. This is the big picture. Sometimes the details that are very important take us too much from the big picture. The big picture of dignity and education and mind and life and faith, all before that, and all of that, and tawheedullah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the big picture in Islam. When somebody asks you, what is Islam? Or they hear something in the news and they ask you, what is Sharia? This should be your answer. That Sharia is about the preservation of these things. And yes, there are rules that differ between different things, and things are going in the law, and things different in cultures. And you could give them the very general answer of cultures and law and so on. But you have to explain Islam through the principles of Islam, through the usul. Usul al-Islam, they call it in the language of the fuqaha, usul al-Islam. This is the fundamentals of Islam, the roots of Islam. So I advise myself and you to, you know, explore more in this topic, and inshallah take care of it more. And it's a great entry to Islam for so many people who don't hear Islam or about Islam this way. Yet this is the correct understanding of Islam that every Muslim knows in their hearts. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us and to give us knowledge and to give us hidayah, tawfiq, and guidance and success. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us and to accept whatever we have done of the little things in Ramadan as something that is acceptable, and therefore make us better people after Ramadan. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep on guiding us and keep on forgiving us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and keep on showering His mercy and His blessings on us, subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of His generosity, subhanahu wa ta'ala, and out of His mercy, not out of anything that we did or we deserve, but out of His generosity, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the most generous, most merciful. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept that. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallah khair,
Professor. So again,
I
just want to remind everyone that
Sharia
is the short course Dr. Jesh is giving will be on Saturday after Dhuhr, along with Sheikh Ahmed Kuti. So from 1:32 is the Salat of Dhuhr. From 2 to 4 is the lecture on the Fiqh of Minorities by Sheikh Ahmed Kuti. And afterwards, from 4 to 6, the lecture, more details on Maqasid al-Sharia by Dr. Jesh. I'd like to thank Dr. Jesh for coming all the way from Qatar to for the sake of Da'an, for the sake of Allah, Jazakallah khair, and feel free to come talk to the students. Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah khair.
But we are one step forward.
They might fail on the preservation of the deen in some aspect, but they don't fail on the preservation of mind or wealth. It's actually, they take a great deal of that.